I'd like to welcome everyone to the Congregational Church of Brookfield. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. And I'd like to invite the ushers, if you will, to pass the pew registers among us. You guys are welcome to sit in Brooks Hall. It's just hard to see the screen. So it's kind of nice to be all snug in these pews together so we can greet one another. And as you sign in, you can look down your pew and see who is here worshiping with us today on your pew with you. So, all the announcements that I had marked, Patrick has up in the booth, and I have Patrick's bulletin, so I will just have to do this from memory. So, first of all, we have a visitor gathering today after this service at 11:30-ish. The second thing is my huge thanks to Jennifer, who is on sabbatical still, and to this entire mission trip team for leading today's worship service, for putting it all together. You really have something great in store for you, which I have already heard. Oh, thank you! Yay! I have my bulletin back. Okay. There is order in the universe. Laura Westby is preaching next Sunday and will be collecting the Neighbors in Need offering, which is why you have your little thing in your bulletin today. Neighbors in Need is the very offering that helps with mission trips around the United States. It's kind of our Homeland Ministries offering where we can fund various outreach programs like the one that is talked about in my bulletin, which is about children who live in food insecure settings, and this is about a program that feeds the hungry with some of our mission dollars with the help of that in Indiana. So if you're able to give to that, you can bring your checks next week or the week after. Walt, I can't imagine what you have to say to us, but whatever announcement it is, we're ready.
How many days, Walt?
26.
All right.
Woo! I'm here with my clipboard. All right. The whistle is still at home, but I may bring it next week if I don't get volunteers. Now, let me just say this. If I have not yet invaded your personal space, then you should come forward today. There are volunteer forms in the bulletin. And with this, I will turn over to Christy McPadden, who is one of this year's fair chairs.
Good morning, everyone. Nice to see everyone here today. We, your fair chairs, would like to share with you a pretty amazing fact. We have raised $181,508 in the past 8 years, with $90,754 going to outreach programs in the area. We thought that was pretty incredible. And to think the fair is almost 50 years old, a lot of hard work and sharing has happened. Are you ready to share? We, your share fair chairs, hope so. Some needs we have. Silent Auction is asking for your donations for the following for this year's Yankee Fair. Related items to be assembled into themed gift baskets, gift certificates for restaurants or services, baskets and or decorative packing materials. Donations may be dropped off at the church during Saturday collection times and expressly noted for Silent Auction. Or you may contact Richard Nyers through the church office to arrange pickup or delivery. The barn is open for donations continuing on Saturdays from 9 to 12 through October 1st. Your gifts through the barn will be distributed throughout the fair booths. aprons. I don't know if you heard, but we're selling aprons this year, $15. They're green with Congregational Church on them, not the year, so they can be reused each year. Reach out to Carol Egan. She's not here today. But Carol Egan is in charge of aprons. They'll be here before the fair. We also have magnets. Well, can you hold those magnets up? Magnets for your car, cars. We're asking for a dollar donation for each of them. They're great advertising, and you can take them off after the fair so they're not stuck to your car. We also have... posters. If anybody works in a type of business where you can advertise for us, we have a box of posters here, 8.5 by 11 and legal size. Feel free to take as many as you need for advertising. And that's it for fair. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. 26 days. Well, then let us center our hearts in a time of silent prayer as we listen now to the tolling of our church bell.
Will you please join me into the call of worship? How shall we get along with one another in this world? We should honor one another with kindness and compassion. Come, let us joyfully worship God in all that we do.
Please join me in the prayer of approach. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations, and we thank you for the strength and guidance to serve you. Open our eyes to your work unfolding among us. Gladden our ears to hear your voice calling us. Open your arms to those in need around us. Gladden our hearts with the joy of serving others and the delight of pleasing you. Bless the work we do. This we pray in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us our day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated, and I'd like to invite the children to come up and to join us up front. Emily and Caitlin have a story to share with you.
Yeah, we do.
Hey, guys, you can scooch over. We don't bite. We promise. Hey. Yeah, come over here. We have a story for you guys today. All right, so good morning, everybody. My name's Emily, and this is Caitlin, and we're gonna share a story with you guys called The Hummingbird Story. And it's something that we were told while we were on mission trip, and we wanted to share it with you guys. So Caitlin's gonna start us off.
All right. When God created the earth, there was light. Then one day, God put a sheet over the earth, and it was all dark. The animals missed the light, so the giraffe decided that she was going to try to move the sheet to let the light in. She said, "I'm tall, so I will go to the highest mountain and take the sheet off the earth." She went to the top of the tallest mountain, jumped, and tried to grab the sheet with her mouth, but she missed. Next, a bear decided to try and remove the sheet. He said, "I am big and have long claws. I will go to the top of the highest mountain and take the sheet off the earth." He went to the top of the tallest mountain, jumped, and tried to grab the sheet with his claws, but he missed. Next, because it's our story, and we get to tell it the way we want, a brontosaurus decided he was going to try and remove the sheet to let the light in.
The brontosaurus said, "I am the tallest. I will go to the highest mountain and take the sheet off of the earth." So he climbed to the top of the highest mountain, jumped off, and tried to grab the sheet with his mouth to uncover the earth. But he missed. So the animals thought that they could not change the darkness. But while the other animals slept, it was the hummingbird, the smallest of all the animals, who decided to give it a try. She flew up to the top of the earth time and time again, each time reaching the sheet. When the other animals woke up and looked up, all they saw was light shining through the small holes the hummingbird had made at the top of the earth, and it was beautiful. It made them happy, and when God saw that, God decided to keep it that way. So the night sky was born, with all its stars and constellations, to let some light shine through the dark.
So, what does this story tell us?
We know that it doesn't matter how little you are. If there's something you want to do, if you work hard, you can make a difference. Thank you.
Now you can go to your church school classes today.
Thank you.
seated.
Good morning. I'm Luke Duval, and I have a scripture reading for you this morning. But first, let us pray. Thank you, Holy One, for your powerful voice calling us to hear you still speaking to us today. As we listen to the words of this ancient letter to your church in Ephesus, bless our thoughts and guide us in your way of love and justice. Inspire us to make wise choices and to walk boldly as followers of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Our reading today is from the New Testament, from the letter to the Ephesians, chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created us in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. May God add a blessing to the reading of this holy word. Amen.
Hey. Hi guys, my name's Sadie, and this was my first mission trip. My work crew this week was me, Emily Lazorchak, Chris and Rod Wetzel, and Kathy Taylor. Our work crew spent the 5 days siding a trailer for our homeowners, James and Charlene, and their 14 cats, 2 dogs, 4 hens, 2 roosters, 2 snakes, many mice, and also many flies. My group worked really hard this week. We all came together tackling the problem of none of us knowing really how to actually side a house, and also the fact that there weren't a lot of studs to nail our siding into. Thankfully, on our worksite, there was another group from a church from North Carolina. Their leader, Greg, had lots of experience siding, so he took the time to come over and help us out, and we're very thankful for him. Really, though, my favorite part of this mission trip was the worksite. It was 8 hours, and it was really sunny and hot, but it was an amazing experience. We all learned so many new things. We learned how to use hammers and nails, and how to cut, and how to saw, and how to measure. Really, these skills will you probably use, hopefully use. And really, at the worksite, another great thing was when you actually finished a job, you had this feeling of pride because you are really helping someone, and it was just an amazing feeling to have. Another great part of this mission trip was meeting the homeowners. Our homeowners, James and Charlene, were an elderly couple, and while they have had a lot of health problems, James had 3 heart attacks, and Charlene was battling cancer while we were there. They were really just so nice and fun to talk to. I remember there's a picnic on Thursdays where all the homeowners come, and we had to drive James and Charlene home, and it was pouring and thundering and lightning on the drive home, and Charlene was laughing because me and Chris and Emily kept pointing out and gasping every time lightning struck, and she was laughing at our childish delight at a storm. And James was in the back seat with me and Chris, and he was spent the whole time teaching us how to drive stick shift and in lots of detail. And while I struggled to understand what he said with his very thick Southern accent, I'll remember his lessons when I learned to drive in March. But besides the work sites, there was other really amazing memories to have. Back at the school which we stayed at, a lot of our church got together to play card games, particularly one called Mafia that was very fun, and it was a coming together of all of us. Another memory of all of us was on the last day there, Jen brought water balloons for us, dyed water balloons, so we all wore white shirts, and out by the basketball court where we were throwing them at each other, there was also a kiddie pool. So the water fight turned into shove each other into a kiddie pool very fast, but it was a really fun time, and it was a lot of laughter and just a lot of smiles to be had. Really, though, there's also a lot of things I'm thankful for at this mission trip. I'm thankful for Mama T forcing water breaks on us. None of us got dehydrated. I'm thankful for long-lasting battery life on the 14-hour card ride home and the whole Hamilton soundtrack to pass the time. And especially, I'm thankful for the people we went with. I'm thankful for the kids and adults, and especially Jen, who just kept us all together And while these activities would be really fun, it was really the people that made this an amazing experience and one that I'll remember forever.
Hello. For those of you who do not know me, my name is Sydney Donnelly, and over the summer I went on my first mission trip to Johnson City, Tennessee, to work with the Appalachian Service Project. Now, I'm not going to lie, I was expecting to have an amazing time with all my friends from CCB, and then at the end of the week, feel really good about all the work I did. Don't get me wrong, both of those things did happen, but what really caught me off guard was falling in love with the 8-hour work days. I was not expecting to be disappointed every single time we had to start heading back to Mountain View Elementary School, our home base for the week. Looking back, one of the things that made the workday so amazing was without a doubt the people I was working with. I had known some of the people in my group before, but I had never really gotten to know them. I think the first time I sincerely thought to myself, this week is going to be amazing, was Saturday night at St. Stephen's Church in Virginia after finding out that for the next week I would be working with Jill, David, Matt, Jack, and Dan. The next morning we woke up and started the second leg of our trip as we all anxiously awaited arriving in Johnson City, Tennessee. By the time we arrived, we were just finishing listening to the song Wagon Wheel for what felt like the 800th time. As both the song and the car dwindled to a halt, we were soon ushered inside by the friendly ASP staff. That afternoon and evening, we were able to spend some time getting to know each other more through card games and brain teasers, all while getting ready for the first work day the next morning. Monday morning arrived, and after getting ready, my group soon arrived at our worksite to meet an 11-year-old girl named Raven and her grandmother, Brenda. After inviting us into their home for the first 15 minutes of our day, I could tell that they were not very sure about us being at their home and on their property for 8 hours a day. However, by the end of our time there, it became clear that Raven was one of the sweetest people I would ever meet, and Brenda was one of the most loving grandmothers I've ever met. After saying goodbye to Raven, Brenda, their parrot, and a chihuahua, we began to replace their porch and steps on the front of their trailer home. It was clear that everyone in our group had the same work ethic when we were able to take down the old structure within an hour of us being there. That day, I learned a lot. A lot about Tennessee, a lot about working, and a lot about making friends and meeting new people. After once again being kindly invited back into Brenda and Raven's home for lunch, I was able to learn a lot about Raven, like how when we were done with the deck, she wanted to paint it purple because that's her favorite color. I also learned a lot more about the people in my group, and I definitely could tell throughout the week that we grew to be much more comfortable around each other, despite not knowing each other that well before. One thing that I really appreciated throughout the week was my group's ability to take a step back and just be in awe of just about everything. Brenda and Raven's home sat on top of a very steep hill, which overlooked a gorgeous barn in front of an even more gorgeous mountain range. The first day, after stopping to take pictures of this magnificent view, we found a river on the way home that we were able to stop and put our feet in. This was definitely a wow moment for me. I was 11 hours away from home in a state I've never been to before, and I was enjoying every single second of it. By Wednesday, we were working towards completing our goal of finishing the deck that day. By that time, Raven was out with us playing basketball with David and sharing an incredible song she had written, which she sung the next night at the ASP barbecue. That Wednesday night, after we had finished cleaning up and saying goodbye, we went to get our daily frozen lemonades from Sonic and say hi to our new friend Seth, who worked there. The next morning, we went to our next project. After finding out we were going to build stairs up to the door of someone's trailer home, we discovered that that person was not, in fact, home. With Jen's people skills and kind help, we were extremely grateful when the neighboring family allowed us to plug extension cords into their home so we could begin working. We were able to finish the second project by the middle of that day due to pure motivation and determination, also known as, well, rain. As we quickly moved on to the next project Thursday afternoon, we discovered that we would be helping Mr. Mattson cover up a ceiling. Not only was the room not square, but the studs were not placed evenly. To put it bluntly, it's no secret that I'm short, and I was kind of annoyed to admit it when asked to go with Jen to help her pick up scraps from another worksite, but within 5 minutes, I was over it. I can honestly say that that was the most beautiful car ride I have ever taken. Words cannot describe the awe I was in and how taken aback I was by that single car ride. Throughout the rest of the week, I had a new perspective on not only working, but life in general. It was clear to see that people were not only thankful for our help, but for their place in life as well. The farm that Jen and I arrived at had lots of animals, and the owners, despite having so little, were able to take pride in their property, their animals, their grandchildren, and so many more things. When we're young, adults teach us to say please and thank you. But being in Tennessee taught me something much more important. Tennessee and all of the people in it taught me to say wow and thank you.
So the first question is, how do you follow that? So listen, I wanted to say a few words about mission trips in general first. By the way, this was a fabulous trip. The kids were great. The chaperones all worked together. It was really a very, very good event. And every single trip is different. This one was very good. The people in Tennessee were extraordinarily outgoing. It really made for a very nice experience. They were very appreciative of what we did for them. They always had a smile and a kind word, so it was really very nice. These programs that we do have such an impact on this church. I have been so lucky over many years to have had the opportunity to do multiple mission trips. We've done some men's mission trips as well. They all bring so much more back to you than you could ever give. So it's really a wondrous experience, and this church should be very proud of that, because it does make a lasting impact on the broader community. So what is a mission trip? We all start these trips. Sometimes you're assigned to do things maybe you're not comfortable with. This applies to chaperones as well as the kids, right? Dan and I and others here have been through multiple mission trips and we're kind of used to the cadence. But for some that are new to that, it's not an easy thing. You know, build a deck. What the heck does that mean, right? Some folks aren't even comfortable picking up a screw gun. But you know what? Every time we do this, people learn. And there's joy in the learning. But a mission trip is all about fellowship, right? We all come together. I know myself, I don't regularly attend like senior youth fellowship meetings. We come together for this experience, right? So it's kind of a fellowship event. And we all start out with this mixed bag of feelings as we get in the car. I'm gonna be away from home for a week. Some people it's like, yes, I'm away from home for a week. Other people's like, oh my God, I'm away from home for a week. So it's a broad range of how people feel as they get into the vans. But we all come together from a fellowship perspective, right? And spend time with each other and collections of people that may normally have never gotten together. So when I look at that whole experience, the week comes down to connections. It's about connections between us. You know, we're a team. It's connections with the other folks that are also donating their time. Right, we go through daily devos, we spend time together, maybe we have entertainment, we eat together. So it's connection to others within our teams. It's also connections to the people that we're servicing. You know, we heard about Raven and Brenda, as Sid was saying. Each and every time, we're creating relationships, right? We're helping people who, frankly, don't have the ability to help themselves. And that means an awful lot. And we've also, by the way, been on mission trips where the folks are very uncomfortable with being helped. It's not always a sunny disposition. We've seen that in the past. But it's still an important connection to make. It's also connection to ourselves, right? As we experience this and go through, we put ourselves in unique and maybe even uncomfortable to some extent situations. It's a growing experience, right? And I'm sure a lot of folks go in thinking a whole set of things, and they come home thinking something entirely different. So it really is a very humanizing experience, but it's a real growth experience as well. We've already talked a lot about the work. There's always projects. The work is important, but the things I've already talked about are the really important things, right? It's these human connections, the outreach, you know, building a deck. Frankly, I love doing that kind of stuff. But that's one project. It's really how you're uplifting your fellow man, right? And no matter what that project is. And Dan and I were lucky enough, we worked on a number of projects, you know, as a team, right? It's a teaming thing. Some projects were ahead, some were behind. We had the opportunity to work on multiple projects, which means we got the opportunity to meet multiple people along the way as well. So it was very, very welcoming. Now, Sid and Sadie have talked quite a bit about, the kind of what was done, so I'm not going to go into that too much in terms of the projects. But just a couple of, closing comments. We live in an environment here in Brookfield of tremendous prosperity. We don't have a clue the things that we take for granted every single day. You know, it just becomes part of the fabric of our existence. When you start going on some of these mission trips and you meet people in different circumstances, it is not the same. So we, every day, we should feel blessed that we're lucky enough to live in this community, in this environment, because believe me, we know prosperity. Most of us don't really know lack of prosperity. And that in some areas of the country is like an open wound. So the last comment I'll make is, you always take home more from this than you could ever do. The time that you spend connecting with other people, the work that you do, to me, it's a soul refresher. It takes you out of the mundane and allows you to give something to somebody else without the expectation of monetary benefit, right? Or anything other than a thank you. And that's very, very powerful. And it really does make you feel whole inside, right? We all get trapped in our day-to-day. This is outside of the day-to-day. So simply, thank you. Thank you to the church for sponsoring these events and for the opportunity for us all to execute them. It's a heck of an event. It's, in some cases, what the folks learn. They carry this with them for many, many years. My daughter still does. And that was years ago when she went on a mission trip. So, you know, thank you for the investment. Thank you for this church, who's, frankly, it's in its history, has always been an outreach kind of church. Just a splendid experience. Thank you.
Thank you all for bringing us along with you on your journey and sharing your stories. So let us now enter into our time of prayer with song. As is our custom, we share our joys and concerns for reasons of prayer before we enter into our prayers. And I wanted to start off with a thank you to the Brown family and the Broyu family for these wonderful, beautiful flowers, which are in celebration of the birth of little Daniela Marie, who I love, was born during our worship service on August 14th. And her father, Tom, asked for prayers for her as she was going into labor. And so I think we should all feel very responsible for this baby. That's all I'm saying. So it's great to start off with a joy. We also got some prayer requests this last week for two people asked that the name Daniel be put on the list. So that represents two people, Wedjan and Amy. We continue to pray for Wyatt and Melissa and Nellie and many of these others that you see on your list. We had a prayer request for a young woman, Caitlin, who's struggling with addiction. I know we want to also be in prayer for those who were victims of the explosion in New York last night, as well as there was yet another 13-year-old shot with a BB gun and another attack on police. So both of those communities are in grief, and so we continue to pray for our nation and all of that we go through. Also, the person that we had scheduled to be our guest preacher on September 25th was Michael Seba, our regional minister. And we had been praying for him for some time as his daughter, Rachel, was in cancer treatment. And unfortunately, it came back this summer, and she actually passed away this last Friday. She was 36 years old and leaves behind a husband and two little girls. So our love and prayers are with Diane and Michael Seba as they're down in Delaware with family. And he will not be preaching here, but I did reassure him that our congregation will remain in prayer for his family. So for whom else shall we be in prayer today? Yes?
Helen and Patsy.
Helen and Patsy. Yes. Marilyn. The O'Malley family? O'Malley. Willis. Yes, Sue?
When I come back to visit my parents, I always feel like I'd like to
for Sue's parents, yes.
The Cordelli.
The Cordelli family. Oh, Tito passed away. Oh, I'm so sorry. Yes.
For Brandon's family?
Yes. Gordon? John and Demetra? Jean, John, Clint, and Donna.
Joyce for Dave Honeyford's birthday today.
Yes, he's celebrating his birthday elsewhere today. Mike Chaffee's father. Yeah, passed away. He's the one who installed our beautiful carpet, so our prayers are with him in the loss of his father. Yes.
Edith and Pete.
Edith and Pete.
Volker.
Evie is 14 tomorrow, and she's in our confirmation class. That's great. Yes.
Prayers for Heather.
Prayers for Heather. Yes.
Ed.
I'm sorry. Ed.
Bill.
Lisa, Greg, and Bob.
Lisa, Greg, and Bob. It's Carol's birthday today. Well, happy birthday, Carol. We celebrated last week. Our co-chairs of Long Range Planning's birthday, Mike Mattson and Maurice Downey, had birthdays recently. So we give thanks to God for your mothers giving birth to you. So we can have indoor plumbing. No, sorry. Well, then let us unite our hearts in a time of prayer. Holy and gracious God, you bless our lives and this world in so many ways. And we do confess that we often take our many blessings for granted. In the midst of this world's troubles and strife, we're grateful for the opportunity we have to come together in worship in this, your good church here in Brookfield, to give thanks for the day that you have made, to rejoice in the new life among us, to give thanks for the life and strength and health and breath that you give us to lift up praise for you in worship, but also to reach out and be your hands and heart and labor force in this world. We thank you for calling us and entrusting us with this mission to bind up the brokenhearted and to release those who are captive from their chains. We pray that you would be powerfully present among us as a peacemaker. We pray for all of those who are living in communities of great need, those who live in communities that are broken with violence and mistrust, especially that mistrust between police officers and peoples of color. We pray for our United Nations, which gathers to meet this coming week as they work for world peace. We are bold to pray for all of those of your children around the world who live in unsafe places, places where bombs explode and where disease and hunger live in refugee camps. We ask that you continue to guide us in all that we do. Bless our families and all of these names of people who we've lifted up for reasons of prayer. And continue to empower us and strengthen us and guide us in a ministry to the wider world, which we offer in your name. Amen. We have a call to share this morning from Sue Duvall.
Good morning, I'm Sue Duvall. I love my church because when I sit in the pew on Sunday morning, I feel as though it's exactly where I'm meant to be. I love the sermons, the pastors, the music, this beautiful building, the laughter, and the kind people. I especially love the opportunities that this church gives us to learn and grow. As a parent, I think it's important to teach our kids that it's not all about them or all about us, and to help others by giving our time, our talent, and our treasures. Through our church's Junior Youth Fellowship, Senior Youth Fellowship, and through missions, as well as committees like CIS, my entire family has had the opportunity to serve, not just our local community, but beyond. From the Super Bowl of Caring, to the Yankee Fair, to the women's mission trip to Providence, and to Senior Youth Fellowship mission trips like this one to Tennessee that all four of us were fortunate enough to be able to attend. These opportunities give us a glimpse into the world beyond Newtown and Brookfield and show us that vast need that exists both near and far. I love to give to the work of our church because I know that it makes a real difference to real people with very real needs. We are a kind, welcoming, caring church family that actively extends its warmth beyond its front doors. And to me, that's an investment that pays great dividends. This morning's offering will now be received. Thank you.
Sometimes in our lives. 16 hours, picking me a bouquet of dogwood flowers, and I'm hoping for Raleigh. I can see my baby tonight. So rock me, mama, like a wagon wheel. Rock me, mama, any way you feel. Hey, mama, rock me. Rock me, mama, like the wind and the rain. Rock me, mama, like a southbound train.
Join with me in the offertory prayer. Oh God, when I have food, help me to remember the hungry. When I have work, help me to remember the jobless. When I have a warm home, help me to remember the homeless. When I am without pain, help me to remember those who suffer. And remembering, help me to destroy my complacency and bestir my compassion. Make me concerned enough to help, by word and deed, those who carry out for my favor. Amen.
Thank you. Please join us in the responsive benediction. How shall we worship our God with our lives? We have heard what the Lord requires of us. Leave empty talk and pride behind. We must walk the walk. Prepare to step out in faith, even into troubled waters. Only God knows where we might need to go. Don't be afraid. Jesus will guide our steps along the way, teaching us to walk humbly, to love boldly, to serve God with body, soul, mind, and strength.
And now I invite you to a time of fellowship downstairs. Our youth fellowship group has provided many delicious things for us to eat, and you can greet them down there. And also, if you'd like to join us for the visitors' gathering, that will be convening down there as well. And so, now as we have been so blessed by the peace and love and grace of Jesus Christ here in this meeting house, let us pass the peace with one another and especially take it out into the world. Go in peace.
Chose to serve and